everyone. This is Brian with Diamond Audio, and as you can see, I'm kind of buried behind some boxes here. Today we're going to start a series talking about motorcycle speakers. And so what we've got here are our four offerings for 6.5-inch motorcycle speakers. What we're going to do is we're going to talk about each one. We're going to have a speaker in a fairing pod, and then we're going to show you some response from the DMRTA. We're going to show you an RTA response, we're going to show you an SPL response, and then we're going to play some regular music and talk about how these speakers work and where we need to cross them over and things like that. What we're going to specifically focus on are the coax speakers that are the ones down on the bottom, and then we're going to talk about the mid-range only. These are the ones that you would add a tweet or two, like an MO75T, or you may want to add the M1SRT. Those are the two most common options. But we're going to talk about all of these, so as we get into this, we will discuss them a little bit more. So here we go. And then I'm also going to flip it over to SPL. I may turn it up a little bit for that, but that way you can kind of see the difference in performance between these two speakers. Both of these being coax speakers, where it has the mid-range and the tweeter in one set, as opposed to a mid-range and a separate tweeter component system like we'll talk about in a minute. Okay, so these are both of our coax offerings from Diamond Audio. So here we go with some pink noise. Okay, so I slowed it down and you're going to hear my peak. That's what the peaks on the end over there are. But if you notice, when I don't talk, between like 31.5 and about 8K, you've got a pretty good spike over here on this side. Down here in that far area over there, you're going to see that spike, okay? So what you would want to do in that application, most of the time you're going to want to use an EQ to kind of equal that out and kind of balance it out with everything else. I'm going to switch over to the MP65. And show you what that one does. Okay, so what you can see on the screen is we have a significant increase in volume kind of across the whole mid-range area, and that same peaky area went way up through the roof, especially your 5K and your 6.3 and your 8, they went real high. And even 4K. But you can tell everything else went a lot higher. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is we're going to set up to do SPL, and I will turn the volume up a little bit more just so you can see an overall difference in the volume of the two speakers. Again, they're running full range pink noise, so it's just the overall of what they will do. Okay, so without even adjusting the volume, we're at about 91 dB on this speaker, on the HXM65F4. Okay, now I'm going to switch it to the MP654. And as you can see there, there was a significant jump by about 6 dB. So basically what that's saying is this is going to be about 4 times as loud as this speaker. Okay. Now what you will see as we go along, and if you watch those graphs, this speaker is going to have a more all-around balanced sound. This one is going to be very loud in the mid-range, and especially in the upper highs and in the lower tweeter area. So in that 4K to 8K, 10K area, these were pretty hot. This does have the resistor included. It's wired in line also to tone the tweeter down a little bit. So you can imagine without that how much brighter that tweeter would be. Okay, so what we're going to do now is show you guys some frequency response on the RTA playing actual music. I've got some Michael Jackson queued up, and then I might throw some Eminem or something else in here. I got a couple songs in a playlist. I just want you guys to see what the speakers look like. So it's going to start out pretty loud, but I'm going to cue it up here. And we're going to start on the HXM65F4, and then I'll let that play for a little bit, and then I'm going to swap it over to the MP654 so you can get an idea of what they sound like. Here we go. If you notice that curve, it's very kind of smooth. It's got some you know, up and down to it, some peaks as the music intensifies its dynamic range. But overall, it's pretty smooth across the board, and that's something that's really good with this speaker. It's an overall great sounding speaker, and it's very even across the board. You're going to see something a little different with the MP654 now when I switch over to it. But dare I take the sound before you make it? And you start to freeze, and so it looks you right between the eyes. Your paradise, cause this is paradise. You guys can see there's a big difference in volume on this one. All that mid-range goes way high on the graph. It's definitely a huge increase in volume. I didn't turn the volume up at all on the system. It's just the difference in the efficiency of the speaker. So lots louder. But again, if you notice, it's all mid-range. It's all in that upper mid-range and highs, you know, well, all the mid-range and then the lower high end. On the top end of the highs and definitely on the bottom end, you don't have the same balance. So very different application for these two speakers, the way you would want to use them. Okay, crossover wise, when you're using the MP654 in a fairing pod like this, and I don't know if you guys can see this, but it's all matted up and you know, solidified, so it doesn't really flex. I even sealed it. I took some foam and took the two pieces apart, put some foam in there and sealed it so it doesn't leak. All the holes are completely sealed. So these are very solid enclosures now. We typically recommend that you cross this over at 100 hertz at 12 with a 12 dB slope. I have it running right now on a 24 dB slope, and I have it crossed over at 80 hertz, and it plays perfectly fine. So if you can put a 24 dB slope on it with a processor, 80 hertz will work. 90 is a little safer, but if you tune the system correctly using an oscilloscope, getting a DD1 to get the gain set correctly, and you can set the crossovers accurately, you can run this at 80 hertz if you've sealed it and made the enclosure rigid. If it's still going to flex and you're just putting it in a factory fairing pod and you don't do anything to the pod, 100 hertz, 12 dB, I wouldn't recommend anything else, okay? On the HXM65F4, these do have a little bit lower bottom end response. The crossover I have set for these, let me tell you, I actually have these on a... So both of them are Linkwitz Riley crossovers. Butterworth or Linkwitz Riley will both work. I have this on a Linquitz Riley 24 dB slope, and it's crossed over at 60 Hertz, and I have played it for a long time. Okay, again, completely sealed enclosure. I have a layer of damping material all around this whole back end, even on the front you can see. So the whole thing is rigid, and it is completely sealed. There are no air leaks. So when you're talking about crossovers and things like that, these are important things to know. If you're just doing a factory replacement and dropping this right into a fairing pod without doing anything to it, I would not use anything less than a 12 dB crossover at 80 Hertz. Okay? If you're going to seal it up and you want to get a little more out of it, then again, 60 Hertz, 12 dB, or sorry, 24 dB Linquitz Riley. But again, make sure that the fairing pod is completely sealed and that you've put some damping material on it to keep it from flexing. All right, guys? I'll play one more tune, and we'll listen a little bit, and then I'm going to go on to the next series of speakers.
May I have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please? Will the real Slim Shady please stand up? I repeat, will the real Slim Shady please stand up? We're gonna have a problem here.
Don't act like you never seen a white person before. Jaws all on the floor, she panicked. Like Tommy just burst in the door and started whooping her ass first than before. They first were divorced, sewing her over first.
Now we're gonna go to the HXM650.
I'm kidding. He didn't just say what I think he did he? And Dr. Dre said, nothing, you idiots. Dr. Dre's dead. He's locked in my basement. Feminist women's off him and him. Chicka, 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 Slim Shady. I'm sick of him.
Once again, a more even frequency response. Gonna have a lot more bottom end to this available. This one is going to be much louder, so if you need the volume more than even, this is the way to go. Now we talk all the time, and I talk to guys all the time about using this speaker in the fairing pods and then doing like the HXM 69F4s or doing the MS69CX coax sub in the lid kits, so you kind of get a balance there. I'm gonna get these swapped out. We're back with the mid-range standalone speakers. This is our MS Pro 65 mid-range, Pro Audio style mid-range. This is our newest offering in the 6.5s. This is the MS65 Neo. What we're going to do is similar to what we did with the other speakers. We're going to compare them side by side, see the frequency response, we'll play some music, and we'll talk about how to set them up, where you can put crossovers, things like that. So the first thing I'm going to do is play the MS Pro 65 with some pink noise. See in this screen, what you were seeing there is the Pro 65 has a pretty good peak at about 200 Hertz, and then from about 1.6K all the way up to 6.3K, it's pretty hot compared to the rest of the response, but it's not a bad response. A little bit of EQ work and it would sound really, really good. They are pretty loud. So I'm going to go ahead and do the RTA response on the Neo. And then we'll look at some SPL numbers as well, some sound pressure level. Okay, so you see a very big difference with this speaker than the Pro. What you noticed on this one, if you were looking at the graph, at about 500 and 800 and about 1.6, and then from like 4,000 to 6.3K, you had these big spikes. And then in between them, you had these dips. Okay, so that can all be worked on, again, with some EQ work in a processor. But definitely more mid-range, upper mid-range. And this one seemed to be a little more balanced with a spike in the lower mid-range, down actually almost into mid-bass. So I want to do the same thing. We're going to show some SPL numbers. And what the SPL does is it just shows you which one's louder than the other on the same frequency at the same volume, playing the pink noise. It's all frequencies. But you'll see which one is a little louder. And then from there, we'll go into playing music and talk about which one kind of has a better sound for music, and depending on what you're looking for. Okay? I'm going to switch over to the Pro, and we're going to play it. What you see is this one is just a slight bit quieter, so the Neo is just a little bit louder than the Pro at that volume. Now, the thing is that these take quite a bit more power. The Pro series are rated at 200 watts RMS. The Neo will do 300 watts RMS in the 6.5s. So this is going to take a lot more power, so it is definitely overall going to be a lot louder once you add more power to it as well. So we're already a little bit louder. It's going to get significantly louder when if you put enough power to it compared to what this will do. Other than that, let's do some music for a few minutes and just kind of listen to them. And then I'll talk about crossover points, and we'll go from there. Got everything ready. We've got the music queued up, so we're going to play some music tracks. I'm going to do some Michael Jackson, maybe a couple other ones. We might just jump through some stuff, but at least a track or part of a track, kind of show what the response is. We're going to start with the Pro 6.5 first. Okay, so what you can really see in that graph is, again, it's still got a pretty hot spot at like 200 hertz. Plays pretty well into the lower region, down into almost the upper mid-bass area. To me, I would definitely be using a processor on any of these speakers to help control them. Again, we'll talk about that more in another video about how a processor helps get you better sound out of the speakers. But this one, really good response, so let's go to the next one. So what you guys are seeing here, if you notice on both of them, they kind of roll off on the top end about 8K or so, right around there. They're starting to kind of roll away from about 6.3 down, you know, or up 6.3. It rolls way off, you know, into 8 and 10K. So because they are mid-range, they're not really designed to play too much above that. This one, the big difference that you saw is that across the whole mid-range area, it was spiking pretty hard. It was going, you know, all of our frequency points were all up, you know, pretty high, all the way up over the top of what you can see on the screen. 200 hertz was even pretty hot on this one, where when we looked at it at pink noise, it wasn't as predominant. But with music, it definitely has a different effect. What I would recommend when you're doing the MS Pro 65s, normally tell you to cross these over to about 150 hertz with a 12 dB slope. If you guys put a 24 dB slope through a processor, I'm running these at 100 hertz. Okay, but that also means that the gains need to be set correctly and things like that as well. You can't just be guessing at what the gain is. So if you're setting them up with an oscilloscope or a DD1 from Damore Engineering or something like that, the SMD tools, then you can absolutely run them a little bit lower as long as you've got the capability to set the crossover to 24 dB slope. Linkwitz Riley or Butterworth, it doesn't really matter. Okay? On the Neo, the 6.5 Neo, This will play, I have the crossover on this one set at 24 dB slope at 80 Hertz. Normally we would tell you 100 if you're not sealing the bag and or sealing the pod. We're going to tell you about 100 Hertz on these. But with a 20, this one seems to be a little more even across the board. This one definitely is hotter in the mid-range and hot, lower highs. Again, all across that thing you saw, it was very, very hot across the middle. So, lots louder and a lot more mid-range out of this versus the Pro. Here we are, last thing on these. So, mid-range only speakers, MS Pro 65, MS 65 Neo. These are mid-range only. The one thing that you do with these is these typically get paired with one of these two. This is the MO75T or the M1SRT. Okay, these are the two tweeters that are our most common that get paired with these speakers. Okay, so that's where you're going to get the rest of your highs from to finish out the top end of that musical spectrum. Okay, so going back a little bit, this was kind of a more had a fatter bottom end sound and pretty good across the mid range. Really hot between like 4K and 6.3K. Okay, this one was really hot, kind of all across the board. Had a few little dips in between some hot spots. Overall, much louder. The HXM 65F4 is a completely waterproof coax. Mind you, these are all water resistant. The MP654 that I'll pick up here again in a second is the least of that, and I'll explain why. These are fully waterproof, fully waterproof, fully waterproof. Okay. This is a kind of a all-around musical speaker. If you're looking for something that's loud, but you want more waterproof and you want a little bit more even sound across the whole musical spectrum from your mid-bass up. Okay, great option. All right, the MP654. Okay, here's the reason why this is not fully waterproof. It's this thing here. Okay, if you get water down into that tweeter horn, there's nothing to protect the diaphragm that's in there, and it can get damaged very relatively easily. It's not super easy, but it can be damaged. So if this is something that's going to see a lot of water, there are some ways that you could go about protecting this to help it. If you have those questions, reach out to me and I'd be happy to help you out. Very, very loud speaker. Okay, that horn tweeter is ridiculously loud. The mid-range overall was much louder than the HXM counterpart. Doesn't play quite as low into the mid-bass, but still gets pretty low and sounds really, really good. If you want lots of volume, this is the way to go in a coax. If you want, if you have any questions, you can reach out to me at brian@dat-cvm.com. I will be back with another video that talks about 6x9s, and then we will do another one on 8s. All right, guys, thank you, and we will see you soon.